In Clause 1 of the bill, government was non-committal on a specified timeline needed to activate midterm access after the bill is enacted. But the Committee of Gender recommended to Parliament to have Section 24A come into force within 60 days of the publication of the Act in the Gazette.
The 60 days are for the Minister to develop a statutory instrument that specifies and spells the regulations and the way they are going to pay out this money. Right Honourable Chair, given that it includes money and calculations and preparation of what to pay to the beneficiaries, Right Honourable Chair, the Minister is required to give the statutory instrument that spells how, when, who is not going to get, how many are going to get, and how much therefore should be prepared.
The amendment that has caused this long debate was to the effect that clause 12, is it? It's in section 1 that commencement. The minister shall, in consultation with the board, by statutory instrument, commence section 24A within 60 days.
My major concern, and the concern of the people of Kampala that I represent, what they have sent me to tell the House or to discuss in this House is in respect to the issue of implementation. The law may be prepared, passed, but the issue to do with the bureaucracy in respect to accessing the funds should be dealt with.
This generated a heated debate on the matter, as many legislators wanted workers to access their midterm savings immediately. It took the Attorney General Kiriwa Kiwanuka to convince Parliament that the Minister of Gender needs the 2 months grace period to develop statutory instruments and preparation of the money to pay beneficiaries and how much should be prepared depending on the health status of the fund.
Partial implementation of the law, Chair, can be problematic. Can we get to understand why not have the law commence at a go so that we have a more certain law in place?
The instrument comes into force and is presented to Parliament for information.
Okay.
And just for comfort of members of Parliament, any statutory instrument which is made which exceeds the powers set in the principles or the sections of the law is null and void and shall not happen on my watch.
But Parliament has given the Minister of Gender strict instructions not to use statutory instruments to deviate from the spirit of the bill by importing guidelines that will make it difficult for savers to access their money.
When we pass this bill, we are going to start immediately drafting the regulation and undertaking consultation. And once it is gazetted, we are very certain, and I want to assure workers that we will undertake consultation efficiently, and if possible, we will not reach the 60 days that has been proposed in the law.
I'm very happy because all the recommendations we made, they have been accepted by my fellow members of Parliament. I think meaning we did a good job. We have recommended that the minister should, the NSSF should be supervised by Minister of Gender, Labour and Social Development. And for those who have attained 45 years and have served at least 10 years, for those they can access their money at least 20% of their saving.
MPs have also overpowered the government and put NSSF under supervision of the Minister of Gender, contrary to the government proposal to have it under the Minister of Finance.
The amendment as proposed by the committee, will those in favour say to the contrary? No. The ayes have it.
Placing the bill under the Minister of Gender was spot on, because constitutionally the Gender Ministry is the one which is mandated to handle aspects of social security.
Parliament and all stakeholders have consulted and agreed that NSSF is supervised by Minister of Gender, Labour and Social Development, and it was a very popular submission, rightly so, because this is emanating from the International Convention of International Labour Organization, which mandates that all social security funds or provident funds being managed by the minister in charge of labor.
Government has conceded on the proposal to give NSSF managing director voting rights on the board after facing resistance from members of parliament who argued that the move will render the board useless.
The managing director of NSSF was also part of the board but had a right to vote. And we think that because the managing director is involved in day-to-day running of the institution and is part of the process that generates policy matters that must be deliberated for by the board, it is not proper that the same person goes and sits on the board and also have opportunity to vote.
Already in the consultation with all stakeholders before we started today, we had agreed that we as government will now support the proposal that the ED or the managing director does not need voting power.
The debate ended in a stalemate as MPs failed to agree on a deterrent penalty for non-compliance against the employers who do not remit workers' contributions. The legislation process resumes tomorrow. Story by Fred Kajibi for the News at Parliament.